Kundera talking about when he talked about Central Europe and culture and these identities and these, they have lasted through culture? He talked me about several things, and it's not now the time to do a complete review. It has to do with the fact that in the last two centuries, many of these peoples have lost statehood but have maintained their existence through the cultural identity. It has to do with the fact that nationality in this area is defined around ethno-cultural lines and not political lines, right? So you can be a Romanian in the Kingdom of Hungary because your ethnicity is not given by your political belonging but by your ethno-cultural belonging, right? It has to do with that, but it also has to do with the importance of culture as a social value. As a social value, not just, you know, on paper or, you know, when you meet, when you go to a diner, I don't think you have diners, a dinner, to go to dinner, a banquet or whatever, and you talk culture, right? No. We're talking about what is the value that shapes your daily life. And the way in which the bourgeoisie, and that's the important part, it wasn't the elites, it wasn't the cultural elites, it wasn't some snotty people in some snotty, you know, places. It was the masses, the mass meaning the middle class, that lived their daily life and based on certain values of true, the good, the beautiful, were considered to be the social values to which you should shape your and adjust your life. So they are inculcated. And a good example of this is that many very rich, the higher bourgeoisie, the upper bourgeoisie, the high bankers, financiers, the Trumps of the time, let me put it this way, were not Trumps of the time. Because what they did is, besides, you know, having economic success, their part of their mission and part of their meaning was to become important financiers of the cultural act. And you're going to say, well, I've heard of that before and so on. Yes. But what's even more interesting is that their sons and daughters, in many cases, and Ludwig Wittgenstein, the famous philosopher, is an example, because he comes from the famous family of the Wittgensteins, who, by the way, are Jewish. That show you what a tremendous social mobility the Jewish people had here, the Jewish groups had here, who were very assimilated, consider themselves Austrian or whatever, comparatively to other countries, I'm saying, at the time. So the Wittgenstein, you know, banker, hugely rich father, his son becomes a philosopher. Not necessarily as this rebellion, right? And it's not just his own example, there are many, painter, whatever. But because in the family in which he grew up, that was the value. The money was a means, the money was a, you know, path or something, but the value that gave meaning to their life was production, consuming, producing and consuming culture, right? And that is important because that creates a way of life and that creates a sphere in which culture can flourish. It is part of everyday life and not just something you do on Saturday evening from 7 to 9. And we're talking high culture, also low culture, you know, some, you know, lower brow theater and so on, whatever, there was that as well, from especially from the lower bourgeoisie. Right? But the stars were, as I said, the cultural stars were the stars and the models for the whole society. The people who about whom you read and to whom you try to kind of idolize, you know. And there's this scene when one of the theaters in Vienna was they wanted to build a new theater, and so they had to take apart the old theater. And there's this famous scene when, you know, there was the day, okay, we're going to close the doors today, and then we're going to be demolished, whatever, when people in mass went and tried to, I mean, they ripped it apart by hand, because they all of them wanted to have the souvenir, had to have a memory, something to you know, like a relic from the theater. And that was the masses. Because it shows you, right, that it was the value it was. And there are other dimensions here. The idea, and the more you read about the culture of the time, again, there are books that, if you're interested, you know, you are free to inquire about it, which I can recommend, to understand life in the empire and cultural life and cultural output in the empire, you know. And some of it which have, you know, shaped the entire 20th century in music, in art, in philosophy, in economics, you know, the Austrian school of economy, always born here. And what is common for many of these will be a spirit of synthesis, not by chance, not by chance, because it is the meeting, it was the meeting place, not of just of cultures, but also of minds. And, you know, you have them, you know, the philosopher professor, you know, who attends this concert and then goes to his friend the painter and drinks with the, you know, the economist and so on, and they would have these multidisciplinary, you know, meetings and seminars, and they would read to each other and rip each other apart, and that was part of their intellectual life. So there are other aspects here, right? A culture of in which, and this is specifically Austrian. This is why I insist, you know, I insist in my note that, you know, even if that we should call the Germanic people here, they are Austrians. Because there's an Austrian culture that is different from the, let's say, Northern Germanic culture. The Austrian, and probably some cliches we have about it, but definitely different, for example, from the Prussian culture. It's not by chance, not Russian, Prussian. It's not by chance that they fought. Right? And aspects of this is a sort of a savoir vivre, as the French say, a way of know how to live well, a valuing of pleasures, not hedonistically, but of the beauty, of a free time spent pursuing art, pursuing the good things, a less Prussian, efficiency obsessed. And more relaxed, more putting the value less on that, you know, but on the higher things, so to speak. And there's this sort of a different sort of a culture here, and that also plays. And these are just examples. They're just examples of how you need to have a heart, you need to have a culture, a more broader culture in which you know, certain values, and it includes order and discipline, and it includes, you know, having a productive life and all these things. But, you know, the higher values are higher values, and those are the cultural values. Those are the what is good, what is true, what is beautiful, what is worth it, you know, worth it. And the respect for that and a pursuit of that, even if in your daily life, and even if you have no clue and you haven't really read much, but you have this sort of a awareness that these are the better things. And this is how you educate your sons and your daughters, and this is what they will pursue then. And this has remained. That's the interesting thing. This is why there is a Central Europe as a space, even beyond borders. Because this is all these aspects of culture, you can still perceive them, see them, and I have experienced them there in daily life, in the life of the middle class, you know, 100 years later. This is why Kundera gives examples of his friends, the Hungarian-Serbian writer Danilo Kiss, who probably was also Jewish, whatever, from whatever. Because this is typical. All this multi-inherent, imbibed, assumed, multi-layered culturality. Yeah. And this valuing of culture over production, so to speak. Yeah. Okay, so that's the other side. That's the other side of things. And in my one of the article I posted, I talk about the way in which these things reflected each other. And I give the example of one of the famous books about the Austrian Empire, which is Josef Roth's The Radetzky March. It's not even fake. You can read it. It's a beautiful book. It's a beautiful literary book. It's a novel, right? But it reflects some of these intricacies of life in the empire, and I mentioned how it reflects also the three key institutions of the empire, which was the emperor himself, the army, the imperial army, which was common for both, and the bureaucracy or administration, which was also penetrating the entire empire. And it's important that you had these institutions that penetrated the entire thing, the emperor as a symbol, but also the army and the administration to a good degree. It's important that you have that because a state is a set of institutions. And without having a common set of institutions like the emperor, like the army, like the bureaucracy, there would have been no empire. And it was funny or interesting to read about how you would hop on the train and it would be, you would go from one corner here in the almost you know, close to Germany, to Switzerland, right, Alps, to back to Bukovina, where it's mostly Jewish or Ruthenian, Ukrainian, and whatever, so Slav, Eastern Slav even, and you would get off the train, go on the train here, get off the train here, and it would be equally orderly. And the people, the train employee, the railroad employees would have the same uniform with the sign of the empire. And that was a visible sign of the fact that it was all part of one, a linchpin. And also what Stefan Zweig calls this feeling of security, of safety. And it is tremendous that in a time of unbelievable turmoil, rise of nationalism, rise of communism, more Marxism, industrialization, move from one era to the other, and on and on and on. This was sort of an attempt to keep things in balance. And of course it fell apart. But it didn't disappear. And perhaps we will have a chance to talk about some of the aftermath, some of the echoes of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, including the fact that, you know, as Kundera points out, there is a century and a common culture. But also, for example, I mentioned is the European Union, the EU. And it's interesting to note that some of the people who will be the founding fathers of the EU, which is a similar attempt of creating a sort of a confederal level of dealing with common affairs at the level of the Europe, while each of the countries, the states, have their own government. So it's not overarching government over them, but it's similar to this. They all have their own governments, but certain things we delegate at the central level. It's very similar, isn't it? And it's tremendously successful, although you mostly read about problems, but it's been around for 60, 70 years already, and it's been peace in Europe because of it, after centuries of war. And guess what? People who have designed the European Union, who have advocated for it, many of them have come from exactly this, and some of them have even been part of the parliament of the empire. And they have experienced how this actually could perhaps work. And also, when you look at the downside of what happened when this whole thing broke apart, with all its many problems, especially this side, because of some bad policies, when you see how what happened afterwards is what? A bunch of small little states. Easy prey to dangers from the inside and from the outside. Two of which will be later on, just 10 years later after the fall of the empire, will be, you know, Nazi Germany and Soviet Russia, and all these small states caught between those two giants. This is why some said that the greatest tragedy of the 20th century was actually the breakup of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Because, as I said, the greatest tragedies of Europe in the 20th century were the World War II, World War I for sure, but the World War II, and you know, the advent of the Iron Curtain of communism, which took, you know, closed down, you know, half of the continent, or a third. And you know, the argument was, well, if this would have been federalized or something, then that could not have had the space to happen. Was it true? You know, counterfactual history is easy to think, but it's worth pondering. It's worth pondering. Okay, so this was a short synthesis of you know, our discussion of you know, Austro-Hungarian Empire. Of course, you will not make much sense of what I just said if you are not familiar with the readings and the material posted, and hopefully this lecture will help you make sense of those, so that you can bring some good contributions to the online assignment.